You're listening to the Author Inside You podcast, a weekly podcast designed to motivate you to finish writing a book, choose a publisher, and build an audience. Keep listening if you're looking to get propelled into the next chapter of your life. And now, it's the Author Inside You podcast.
Hello, I'm Matt Rafferty.
And I'm Leah Rafferty.
Joining us today is Melissa Lyons, a best-selling author and life coach, helping people find hope and heal after heartache. Melissa is the author of I Will Always Love You, A Journey from Grief and Loss to Hope and Love. Welcome, Melissa. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Matt and Leah. It's great to be with you.
Melissa, can you tell us your thought process on your first book?
I would love to. And it's not a typical one. And you probably hear a lot of not atypical processes. But I sold a business about 5 years ago. And after selling it, I was really left feeling lost because it was a successful, positive experience. And I felt pretty much hopeless and unfulfilled professionally. And so I started on a new path where I was decided that no more was I going to live my life not knowing, like not having a real attachment to a meaning that gave value to me. And so fast forward 3 months that I was going to give myself time to figure it out to 30 months, I was journaling one day and the full book just found its way to the paper of my journal.
Wow. And
I had no idea that I was writing it, what it would be about, that it would rhyme, the impact and the power it would have on my life. So yeah, that's what happened. I had no idea it was going to happen.
And just like that, the whole book?
Pretty much, yeah. Like 80% of what you see in the final version of I Will Always Love You was there. And you know, this is how, so I started journaling therapeutically. I didn't even want to journal, but I was told so many times throughout my life, you know, as I was working through different, like I was starting to like transform and transition, like my thinking to feeling better and feeling more free and more aligned. You know how we all, like the older we get, the more we just want to have that sense of purpose and meaning in our life. And so I started journaling. And so that's kind of what happened. And, but I make mistakes and I start out like, you know what, like words come from anywhere and I'll write like boat, tree, water, coffee, chocolate, banana, chair, until I forget that I'm writing words sometimes. And that's what happened on that particular day. And so not only did it all come out like 80% as it was, but there were no mistakes. It was like beautifully written. It was the craziest thing.
This must have been a surprise. And then how do you go from there?
Yeah. So since, yeah, it was a big surprise and I had to think about what I was going to do because my husband was actually with me and we were on vacation and he came out from where he was doing. He said, like, what happened to you? You look like something happened. And I said to him, I think I just wrote a book. And he rolled his eyes like, oh my goodness, here we go again, you know? And I said, can I read it to you? And as I started to read it to him, so I already read it a couple of times. It takes about 5 minutes to read. So it's not that long. And I couldn't. I was sobbing uncontrollably. I had a physical response, like my body and like everything. It was it was just like a wild experience. And so I knew then that I had to do something with it, that it wasn't just something that found its way to my book. It's like if someone dropped a puppy off at your doorstep.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't just, even if you didn't know what to do with the puppy or you didn't know if you wanted a puppy, you would have to do something to make sure that puppy was okay. And I felt that those words were brought through me for a reason. For something bigger than me. And so, yeah, I embarked on the mission to bring it to the world. And I had no idea how.
Wow.
I didn't realize that at the time, but it was a few months later that I started to put the pieces together again. And or like, not again, but for the first time. And I had read a book by Sanaya Roman called Opening to Channel. Because I had said to somebody, I wish I could channel. I want to know how to, how to get those signs. And you know, I never put it together that I must have channeled the book because I wasn't aware that it was happening when it happened. And yeah, that was my first experience having some kind of like download like that. And I depending on who's listening and what they think, but for me, it was like something very foreign that's not so foreign anymore.
So now you have this in front of you. How did you turn it into a book?
Well, so I had to decide if the words to me, although they rhymed and they're few and far between, they have a big adult message. However, it's such a beautiful story that I thought this has to be, this has to show something for children. And I also asked, like, now I learned how to do this universal connection thing from this time. And so I said, like, what am I supposed, you gave me these words. I don't know what to do with it. Like, what now? And they said to me, this book is for everyone, big or small. It's for the child who lives within us all. These words were sent to comfort you. Take time to read them. You'll know what to do. Hmm. And it just was just like that. And I thought, okay, it's for the inner child. So, yeah. So I had to get it. I looked for an illustrator, and that journey took me to many different continents, actually, on a virtual tour to find an artist. And I ended up finding one in Detroit, talented young woman. And she did the artwork, and the artwork is just stunning. So that was the first step.
Yes, it is very pretty.
Thank you.
So wait, before you stop there, can you tell us about the journey of looking for an illustrator?
So I started to just Google things, and I went down a bunch of different little rabbit holes, so to speak, and didn't get anywhere. And then I went on something called Behance, and there were a few different things, and it wasn't that easy for me for whatever reason. So then I started to interview them by typing back and forth by email. And then finally, when I came to Mary, and her work resonated with me, and I asked her why she wanted to illustrate the book. So then I sent her the script. So I knew enough from talking to her that I liked her artwork, and I liked how she talked. So I sent her the book, and she read it, and she said, my grandfather recently died, and my grandmother is still really grieving and having a hard time. And I think this book would really help her.
Wow. Wow.
And I was
so
like,
she's
okay.
Meant to be. Yeah.
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 I got the chills.
That's somebody you wanted on your team. So then you worked out a deal with her. And then how long did it take her to create the illustrations?
So this was really something. So I wrote the book. Like, this happened in my journal on January 10th, 2017. I found Mary by maybe the end of February 2017. I had all of the artwork done just around Mother's Day.
Wow.
Amazing. Amazing. So we had, I think, 18 or 20 spreads. So this is what, again, I didn't know anything about what I was doing, right? So I just sort of like winged it. And so I had 18 different spreads, and we talked about how they would look. And then she illustrated them all. And we would meet like in cafes in Detroit, which was kind of in the middle of our two houses. Yeah, that's what happened. Then we started to put it together so that we could get it printed.
Well, that must have been extremely exciting.
It was, yeah.
Because a lot of people we've spoken to don't really meet the illustrator either in person. So I would think that actually physically seeing her must have been a joy.
Yeah, it really was. And, you know, it was so interesting in so many ways, because when you look at the book, the children have like gray skin and no faces, and they have hearts on them. And the hearts change color as they go through this journey from their grief to their hope. And there's so many ways that we aligned on that spiritual sense. So to meet her, you're right, you just tied it all together. And she's the same age as my children.
Okay.
So, you know, it was that thing too, that feeling of, I could see that she grew from the process as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, that's wonderful. And I do like the hearts on their back. I think that's pretty cool. Was that your idea or hers?
The hearts. Okay. So the hearts were mine. Nice. But she started them like kind of blue, and the colors changed. They start out kind of cold and isolated, and they end up white light. So that was Mary's changes.
Great.
She added that.
Great.
Mm-hmm. The no faces was her. She wanted the children to be able, anybody to pop into the child.
Oh, okay.
And the gray skin was really important to me, because I wanted any ethnicity also to feel like the words in the book could resonate.
Wonderful.
So
wonderful.
It's basically anyone.
Yeah, anyone who's ever been a child or having any child, right? And has lost somebody or something. You know, I realized too that the book, at first I thought it was about death, and that scared me, because I was like, is this a premonition that something might happen to my family?
Oh.
That's something that you should know too. I had never experienced loss that wasn't like just part of normal living.
Oh.
So
okay.
I'd never gone through anything that wasn't relatively like okay to sort of work through. And neither had my children or my husband. And so it really scared me at first.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Wow.
But I found out later that it's more about loss, meaning loss of who you were, loss of what you did, loss of who you were with, or loss of a life. Like, it's a lot of different loss losses that this book can actually speak to.
Well, Melissa, after you had the illustrations finished with Mary, what was the next step in getting it published?
Well, then we had to lay it out. So we had to pick a font, and we had to pick a font that we had to pay for, because my goal was to sell millions of books. So we couldn't have a font that didn't have a license that would support that. So that took a long time to pick the font. And then we had to decide where the placement of the words would go on the illustration. Second book around, I knew to leave spaces for the words in the illustration. First time around, I didn't know that. So there was a quick lesson for people. So then we figured all of that out. So then I wanted to get it printed. So once the layout was done, I had to decide where it would be produced.
I never knew that. You can't just use Arial or Bank Gothic in your book. You'd have to pay to use that in an illustrated book?
I think you could use any standard font, but there's a lot of fonts that you can buy that are beautiful that they tell you that you can use for home, and they're free fonts. So the first font that we picked actually was a free font. We realized then that we had to buy the commercial license for it. So any of us could use it, and we could do our own little artwork. But if we wanted to use it and produce things from it, we had to buy the commercial license for it.
Oh, that's really interesting.
And we wanted something special. Yeah. Like the font that we used for I Will Always Love You is called Beautiful Every Time.
Oh, that's
okay.
Yeah. So we bought the commercial license for it.
Huh. Very interesting.
Did you consider having Mary write the book as she was illustrating it?
Yes, we did, but it wouldn't have worked, because now, when you go to do different marketing things and different things that you can, complimentary products and stuff, you need to have that font that you can change.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, so yeah. And there's, as much as there's only a few words, there are a lot of words, and it's too much to have someone write, I think.
All right, so now you have the illustrations done. What comes next?
So the illustrations are done. The words are all figured out where they can fit into the book. Then I had to decide where I would get it printed and how I'd get it printed. And actually, one step that I didn't tell you about in the beginning was that I had to pick which size she was, because she did it by, I wanted watercolor. And so she hadn't been doing watercolor for a few years. So she got out her watercolor brushes and started from scratch in that sense. But I had to tell her what size of canvas to use or what size of art paper.
Okay.
So I decided on 10 by 17 so that it could be 10 by 8.5. And so I went to the bookstore and I literally looked at probably 50 different books. And I looked at the shapes. I looked at how many pages mine would be versus theirs. I looked at the type of paper that I wanted. I looked at all of the different books that I liked at the bookstore. And then I was able to buy one so that I could send it to the printer, because I didn't know what kind of paper to say.
Sure.
I didn't know how thick the cover would be or what the jacket would look like. So I literally bought one that I loved and said, copy like all the physical attributes of this book. Because the language of the paperweight and all of this. So that's how I thought it was pretty good to figure that out.
Yeah, that is a great idea. I want it to look like this.
Yeah. So, I like how it felt in my hand. I liked how the paper felt when I turned the pages.
And you had the book printed in China?
Yeah. So then I went on Alibaba.com to find a printer. We were using WhatsApp and Google Translate and having to talk, at 12-hour intervals. When they're going to bed, when I'm waking up and vice versa. But yeah, it was good. And being on the Alibaba platform gave me that sense of comfort, because they have their insurance policy and everything like that, that you'll get what you've ordered.
And then they met all the requirements that you wanted with your book.
So what I had to do then, because they had to literally see it. So I airshipped the actual book. So I bought the book the book that I wanted to replicate. And I sent it to them, and then they quoted the book based on the paper, the everything that they had there. So it was really good, because they were able to give an exact quote. And I should say, tell you too, that when I wrote the book, I was journaling and I had a really beautiful journal. So I also made a journal to match the book. So I got two things printed. So I had to mail both of those to China so that I would have both pieces of the book come back.
Wonderful.
Oh, that's great.
That's great. So then people can start their own journey.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, what was the process like getting the books back from China?
Well, it was interesting, because I was really anxious, obviously, to get my hands on a book. So after I sent them the mock book, or the book that I wanted them to do, they sent me a mock book back, and they emailed it back to me. And I got to look at it, and it was really like a rough version of the book. to make sure that the pages were in order, everything like that.
Sure.
So I got that and then I could give him the go ahead. So that was super exciting. And then my first order, I ordered 2,000 of the books. I wanted them faster because 2,000 books from China to Canada, because it takes longer to come to Canada than the United States by about 2 or 3 weeks. Hmm. Yeah, it's an interesting thing that I didn't know. So they shipped me more expensively, my first 200 and then the 1,800 followed by sea.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that was kind of, that was an interesting thing. And they, you have to get a broker. You have to figure out how to pay the duties, how to bring them into your country. So there's really neat things like that to get to learn. And it's not very hard. It just was something new.
Wow. You Great. Learned a yeah. lot.
I did. I really did. Yeah. So then all of a sudden I've got cases of books at my house and then I had to figure out how to get them out into the world.
Right. And with more cases coming.
Yeah. Right.
So how did you get them out into the world?
Well, I started just talking about it on, like, Facebook was the first one. I had people, you know, kind of all over Canada and the United States getting ready for the book. I'd been talking about it. And so people started to, like, be ready to receive them because I needed reviews and I needed to have feedback to help support the sales. I also had to set up an account on Amazon because I didn't have a distributor. And, you know, let me just backtrack also. So when my book was back from Mary, and even when I got that first mock-up book, I still thought that a publisher might want this awesome book that's like the best thing on earth. Sure. And nobody wanted it. You know, nobody wanted this nobody. And that was really humiliating.
Well, it's timing too. We're learning by yeah. talking through authors. A lot of it is timing.
It is. And patience. And mm-hmm. I didn't have any patience. I mm-hmm. didn't want it. So even if I would have found a publisher that wanted to work with me, I had a 2-year window ahead of me. And I just felt like this came through me so fast. Mm-hmm. I needed to get it out there fast. Yeah, looking back, right. we'll never know if I was right or wrong, but probably I was a little bit too impatient.
Yeah, I right. would think since it was created the way your book was created the way it was, that I would have the same feeling like, oh, this is meant to be. There's a reason why this happened this way. I have to get this out.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And early stories started coming in too that really like fueled my passion to get it out there. So I got the book on Amazon. I had it in local stores.
Great.
And that's how it started going. And then I went to some grief groups and different things like that. And then I started selling it in bulk and I was selling cases to like this different organizations like hospices or some funeral homes oh. or some children's mental health. And a few Wonderful. School boards bought it in the beginning. So yeah, so the early sales started to pick up really well that way because they wanted one for all of the people or for all of the classrooms, things like that.
That's great. And you were just going out and hitting the pavement and selling them that way?
I was. And then I have a friend, an old neighbor who was working, selling to gift stores. So she and one of the people she worked with started picking it up and doing it as an add-on at the end of their sales calls. And the gift stores really, really liked it because there wasn't anything like it. So then I had a lot of sales that way as well, just here in my own home province, not really nationally, but provincially, I had a lot of help there too.
Wow, that's yeah. wonderful.
It sounds like we're over 2,000 by now.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That first maybe 18 months before I got that, I really got into that distributorship, I sold 8,000 books. So that was pretty exciting. Wow.
That's wonderful.
And, yeah.
And so then you called Alibaba back and said, send more and send more?
I did it one more time. And the second time, yeah, it wasn't quite as great as the first time, but it still worked out. I had a little bit more anxiety. So when my second book came out, I still went through China, but I found a print broker rather than going through Alibaba. And so the process was almost the same, but I had an intermediary person. So the price was still just as good, but I had like someone in the United States who brokered it for me and it was much better.
Okay. And that's Until We Meet Again, From Grief to Hope After Losing a Pet. That's your second book?
Yes. Yeah. So I would recommend that to people. Like, so if anybody's thinking like, what do? I would say, if that's where you want to go and that's where you want to print it, you find yourself a print broker because the price will be the same and you have so much more peace of mind.
Okay. That's good to know. So you just found him looking online?
Actually, I didn't. I found him. He was referred to me from someone who had already used him. It was like a warm referral.
Okay.
And I've since referred him to many people and they've had great results with him too. So that's nice. He's a gentleman out of Pittsburgh.
Great. Okay. So Almost everyone has heard of Jack Canfield, the author of Chicken Soup for the Soul. And I was checking out your website, and I see that you have a testimonial from him for both of your books, Melissa. How did you do that?
I do, and it was really exciting. I ended up going to an author's workshop in his home so that a couple times a year, he opens up his home to set a maximum of 17 authors. And wow. Yeah, and so everybody gets time with Jack and a few other people at the front of the room, like Patty Aubrey, the president of his companies and stuff like that. And so they talk to you about your book and all their ideas and what they would do. And everybody else listens to your time on the hot seat.
Oh.
So you get all the information from them, plus everything that they tell all the other authors.
Oh. And,
yeah, so it's so powerful.
That sounds great.
Yeah. And so when I had my time with Jack, one of the things that's interesting is that they tell you, don't talk too much. You're there to listen. And more than half the people forget that. So I actually asked him if he would read my book to the whole group. And I don't think that anyone's done that before, because normally you wouldn't have such a short book, so you couldn't do that. But it was really powerful because when he was done reading it, no one said a word for maybe 10 or 15 seconds. It was so, so emotional. And he loved it.
Great.
And what a great testimonial he left you. That was just very nice of him.
You know what? It was. But let me tell you, it wasn't the testimonial that did it for me, being there. I went there for a number of reasons, and I think a lot of authors might find themselves in this situation. Whatever story you're telling, it's coming from a part of your soul, and there's that vulnerability that you have when you put it out to the world. And I was in search of confidence from deep within me to take those steps forward, and I got so much of that, of just being there with everybody, that it was that. Like by the time I left, I didn't need his endorsement as much as that's why I went there, but I'm grateful for it. Don't get me wrong. But just the power in that going through the process of being with everybody, going through the same process, was just life-changing.
Oh, I bet. What an experience.
Scribifio is the proud sponsor of the Author Inside You podcast.
Looking for ways to improve your writing? Scribifio is the place for you. Scribifio is famous for the detailed and helpful critiques their members exchange. The critiques are so much more than just giving each other a pat on the back. You'll actually receive information that will help you improve your writing. As part of their community, you'll be writing critiques for others also. Their members tell them again and again that learning how to write great critiques dramatically improve their own writing.
At Scribifio, you can learn from the vast collection of free writing resources. Besides the insightful critiques you'll get in the writing workshop, Scribifio has a huge amount of free resources in the professional writing blog and writing academy. Their writing forums are busy with thousands of writers from all over the world talking shop.
Scribifio is also a great place to make lifelong friends in the busy community of writers. Although writing is a solitary act, that doesn't mean you have to be lonely. Lucky for you, there are thousands of writers on Scribifio every day, and they're really a friendly bunch.
You've never seen a writing group like this one at scribifio.com.
Since your books deal with grief, can you tell us one thing that people maybe don't realize about grief?
Yes, I can tell you. I can tell you a lot that I've learned about grief because I hadn't really, like I said, experienced it before writing this book. But I had, and I didn't really understand that grief is just about anything that you've not really been able to let go of and that you carry. So that grief, it could be regrets, it could be unfulfilled dreams and wishes, and it could be the obvious of losing someone you love. So I learned that about grief. And the other thing that I learned is that my approach to it isn't typical, and neither is the book. Because the book talks to people about living your life with permission to follow your dreams and to understand that life is going on regardless of what you're going through. So whatever you're going through, make sure you're aware that there is, like people say, take as long as you want to grieve. And I say, yes, okay, I agree. Take as long as you want, but recognize that there's a bigger life waiting for you. So try to do it with hope in mind.
Great.
So the end of the book that says, be the one that shines the light that was mine. Honor me now by letting yours shine. Is that permission that when we're living, we should live fully because we get to.
Mm-hmm. Well, it sounds like a wonderful book. I think your book can relate to everyone because, like you said, it's not just on what everyone's idea of grief is, but maybe there are women who wake up one day in their 50s and say, oh, this wasn't the life I thought I was going to lead.
Well, Leah, like you just described me, because I was literally 50 years old and 6 days when this book came through me. And as I said to you, I didn't know why I was getting it, why it came through me. And 18 months, give or take, after writing the book, I was snowed in Philadelphia in a hotel. And really, it was not a nice situation. I was in a horrible hotel. I was feeling sorry for myself because I missed a meal and I thought I was hungry. Mm-hmm. North American style, right?
Uh-huh, not really. Right.
And I woke up the next day, and really did a long meditation. And all of a sudden, it was so clear to me that this book, for me, was just a message from one part of me to another part of me. And it was talking to me, giving me permission to step out of the person and the life that I'd been living my whole life and step into this new life and not grieve and be have the grieving loss of the life I'd been living my whole life, but actually fully step into this new life.
Great. What a moment. You keep having these moments.
I know, but it's true. It's actually permission to step into the life and the purpose that we were all here to serve and to do. But we get caught up in following what society thinks we should do, or our parents or our teachers or just the choices we make. Mm-hmm. Now we've got mortgages to pay. And then we lose sight of what we were meant to do, why we were brought here.
Wow. Well, I think that's wonderful because I know there's a lot of people who could use your book.
Well, I sure needed it.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, my life has never been better. I spent the first 50 years of my life, like just not with everything on the outside, so good and so together and not missing, not in need of anything, but just not having that thing that I needed to feel whole.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause I didn't have that sense of being connected to a higher purpose. And the book and the experience has given that to me.
It sounds like a wonderful journey. And I just think it's so cool that it, you know, it's a reason why it came to you, a reason why this all happened. And just congratulations and for following your thought process and believing in what was told to you.
Thank you. And I have to say, talking to both of you, knowing what you're doing, I wish that I would have been able to listen to your podcast, because I'm so aware of the journeys that other people have. And I didn't even know not that I didn't know they existed. They just weren't in my radar.
Sure.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And I love that you're helping people find an easier way to get their messages out to the world.
Well, thank you. That's very kind. Thank you.
Well, that's our goal, to help people.
Right. That is.
So what advice, Melissa, would you give to somebody who's listening to this and they have a book in them and it's not complete or they haven't finished it? What would you say to them?
I think the most important thing that you can do is have a vision and a purpose tied to why, your why. Because mine got lost along the way a lot of times. So if you're tied to a vision and a purpose of why you're doing or why you want to bring it to the world or what you think that it's going to do and what purpose it will serve, your path will sort of illuminate and fall in front of you, because I believe that, you know, what we radiate, we attract. And so as long as you're thinking where you want to go and you're looking like, you know, where you are and a little bit ahead, everything will kind of fall into place. But if you lose track of your why and you get caught up in all the people who want you to do it their way, and how, because there's 1,000 ways to do it, right?
Sure.
But you only need one.
Right.
Right.
That works best for you. Right.
Yeah. And everybody wants a piece of you. Once you start searching, all those messages come into you and all the people. And I'm sure all 1,000 people can help you. But if you try to get help from even 20 of them, you've already kind of lost your path because it's got too many people on it. And yet, this is your journey. So, you know, like, stay the course and keep coming back to your sense of purpose and your why so that it's true to you.
Wonderful advice.
Excellent. And Melissa, how can people get in touch with you if they want to reach out and talk to you?
I would love it if people want to reach out and talk to me, ask me questions. I, like you, I really want to help people in as many ways as I can. So my email is melissa@melissa-lyons.com. And that's Melissa hyphen Lyons, L-Y-O-N-S.com. And my website is melissa-lyons.com. So I have a lot of resources that I'm happy to share. And anything I can do to help will make me happy. It will fulfill my dreams too.
Oh, that is great. And we'll have all those links right there in the show notes.
Well, thank you, Melissa, for offering to reach out to our listeners.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to be able to do that and connect with people. I love what you're doing. Like, literally, wish that I would have known you 3 years ago.
Well, thank you, Melissa. It was great talking to you.
And you guys as well. Thanks so much.
We'd love to hear what you think about our podcast.
Our contact information is at theauthorinsideyou.com. And until next time,
right on.
Thank you for listening to the Author Inside You podcast with your host, Leah and Matt Rafferty.